Welcome back, dear students. For today's class, we are going to discuss on the flexural strength of prestressed concrete sections. That is, what happens in a concrete section or a prestressed concrete section under flexure under ultimate loaded conditions. So first, we need to understand what are the type of failures in flexure. So the flexural failures depends upon the percentage of reinforcement, how much percentage of reinforcement we have provided. That is the total amount of steel. The degree of bond between the concrete and the steel, and the ultimate tensile strength of the tendons provided in prestressing. Accordingly, there are various kinds of failure modes in flexure. The first one is the fracture of steel in tension. That is, the steel will get elongated and it will get fractured. When the percentage of steel is very low, that is very less, 0.2, very less than 0.2% for mild steel and less than 0.15% for HYSD. It occurs when the stress transformed to the steel from cracked concrete make it overstress. That is, the basic assumption is that the concrete will take all the load. Once the concrete cracks, or when the cracking has occurred, only the stress in the steel gets, or there occurs the load will be taken by the steel. So once the concrete, when the stress transformed the steel from the cracked concrete, that is after the concrete has cracked, only the stress in steel get transferred, and then the overstressing occurs, and there occurs the fracture of steel in tension. And the next one is failure under under-reinforced section. Failure of under-reinforced section that we have studied in the last semester also. The steel yields first, followed by crushing of concrete in the compression zone. So here large deflection will be seen and wide cracks in large members also will be seen. Now the failure of over-reinforced section, that is sudden crushing of the concrete. There will be small deflection because it says sudden failure, brittle failure, narrow cracks in small members, stresses in other steel is well below the proof stress, that is it won't reach its yield stress. Now the other modes of failure are web shear cracks, that is due to excess flexure there can occur web shear in, cracks in the web, then web crushing, that is due to the higher shear, high compressive force, then bone failure in pretension members, that is there occurs bone loss of bondage, and as a result there can be failure due to flexure. Anchorage failure in post tension members, that is the anchorage block can fail, and as a result this can fail in flexure. Now in order to determine the flexural strength, there are different methods. That is, method of determining the flexural strength can be based on the principle of mechanics, that is the compatibility of strain and equilibrium of forces acting in the section at the stage of failure. That is, we will see the compatibility of strain, that is the plane section remains plane before and after bending, those things we will see, and based on the equilibrium of forces acting on the section, we will derive certain equations in order to find the flexural strength at ultimate load. There are also some simplified caudal provisions used to determine the flexural strength. So we just need to have an understanding of this method, and we will solve the numericals using this simplified methods. Now we will see the analysis of a rectangular section. This thing I have taken from the NPTEL lectures. So you can see here, for a rectangular section having area of prestressing steel denoted by APS, having width B and effective depth D, the following sketch shows the beam cross section, the strain profile, the stress diagram and the force diagram. So you can see here, it's very much similar to what you have seen in the last semester for a single reinforced section. So the strain profile, you can see here the maximum strain in concrete as 0.0035, and after that the concrete will crush or it will fail. And here you can see the epsilon PU, that is the ultimate strain in prestressing tendons, and delta P, that I will tell you in detail, that is the change in strain due to the transfer of strain from steel to concrete. Then that is here the stress block, that is 0.446 FCK, you have studied how it came, the curve 1, 9, 2 and 3 design curve for concrete. And here that is the FPB, that is the stress in tendon at the time of failure. And XU is the depth of the neutral axis, and 0.42 XU is the location of the compressive force from the top fiber. And CU and TU represents the compressive force and the tensile force respectively. So you can see here those things what I have said, that is APS is the area of the prestressing steel, sigma P, epsilon P is the strain reference, XU is the depth of the neutral axis at ultimate, sigma PU is a strain in prestressing steel at the level of center of gravity of the steel at ultimate load or at failure. FPB, that is a stress in pre-stressing steel at ultimate or at failure. I have represented this in terms of the notations given in your IS 1343-2012. Now you will see the conditions at ultimate limit state. In the limit state method of analysis, the limit state of collapse or ultimate state of a member under flexure is defined as the state when the extreme concrete compression strain reaches a value of 0.0035, that is, it's the maximum compressive strain in concrete. At ultimate, let the extreme concrete compression strain be denoted as epsilon Cu. As you can see here, this is denoted as epsilon Cu, and that value is 0.0035. Now, depending on the amount of pre-stressing steel, a section can be under-reinforced or over-reinforced. For an under-reinforced section, the amount of pre-stressing steel is less and the steel yields before the extreme concrete reaches its strain of 0.0035. That is, the reinforcement will be in such a way that the reinforcement yields first. At such a section, the reinforcement yields before the concrete, and such a section is called as an under-reinforced section. This we have studied in the last semester. Similarly, for an over-reinforced section, the amount of steel is very much high and the steel does not yield at ultimate. The concrete will fail at the beginning of the ultimate load, and as a result, a crushing of the concrete will take place. Now, the transition situation is called as the balance section. That is, in between these two, there is a transition stage, and that is the balance stage. That is, the amount of steel will be in such a way that the strain in steel and concrete will be reached simultaneously at its maximum. The strain profiles across the depth of the pre-stressed flexural member up to the depth of the center of gravity of the steel for the three situations are shown below. So you can see here, that is, sigma pu is the ultimate strain or strain at the ultimate load. It is greater than sigma pu balance for a balance section. You can see here the strain in concrete is very much high. Now the second case is sigma pu is equal to sigma pu balance, and this has occurred the maximum. You can see here when this occurred, this reached 0.0035, this is very much high. This is greater than the required for a balance section. Here when it reaches 0.0035, it is equivalent to this strain in a balance section, and this is when it reached 0.0035, it hasn't reached the strain for a balance section, which means it is an over reinforced section. I hope you are clear with this. If you have any doubt, you can ask me at any time. Now we will discuss on this new term, that is your delta epsilon p. Now you can see in the above scale, this epsilon pu represents the strain in pre-stressing steel at the level of CGS at ultimate condition. Sigma epsilon pu balanced strain in steel for a balance section. Now the new thing, that is the strain difference, is a strain in the pre-stressed tendon, because the concrete tendon, as I have told you at the beginning of the classes, the tendon is in a stressed state, which means it is a strained condition, and the difference in strain in the pre-stressed tendon when the adjacent concrete has strain zero. That is, the strain difference in the strain difference, say epsilon delta epsilon p, is a strain in the pre-stressed tendon when the adjacent concrete has a strain epsilon c is equal to zero. The strain difference get low during the transfer of the stress. That is, when we transfer the pre-stress, there is a constant value, and that value is called as a strain difference. The value can be determined as follows. Now for pretension members, we are giving the strain at the beginning and we are cutting it. At that time, the strain difference get locked and the tendons are cut. The strain difference at that instant is given as delta epsilon p is equal to delta pi minus zero. Here you can see, for a pretension member, the strain in concrete at the initial stage is zero, because at the beginning, before pouring the concrete itself, it is under the strain condition. So there won't be any strain in the adjacent concrete. And as a result, for a pretension member, the strain in concrete is zero, which means delta epsilon p is same as the strain in tendons just before transfer. Now for the post tension member, when you see the strain difference, that is delta epsilon p, gets locked and the tendons are anchored, that is, we are anchoring it, and at that time the strain in tendons get locked, and that value is the strain difference at that instant is given as delta sigma p is equal to the strain due to the pre-stressing force p naught And the strain in concrete due to this P naught. There will be some strain in concrete due to this P naught. So the difference in these two is delta epsilon P, and that value will be there throughout. Now the remaining value will be taken by the steel. That's what you have seen. In general, at any load case, I can write delta epsilon P is equal to the strain in steel minus the strain in the concrete due to this pre-stressing force. The strain in the pre-stressing steel minus strain in the pre-stressing force. So this basics we need to understand. Now we will move on to how we determine the ultimate strength in flexure for a rectangular section based on this understanding of your sectional property as well as the stress diagram. We'll just need this strain diagram in order to understand how the equation had come. Okay, now you can see the Indian standard provision IS 1343 for a determining the ultimate strength or flexural strength for a rectangular and T section. You can see the same in Annex D. You can see the same in Annex D of your IS 1343 2012. The moment of resistance for rectangular and T section. But before that, you need to have a clear idea of what all things we require here. That is, you are having a rectangular beam. The width of the section is B. The effective depth of the section is small d. That is, from the top compression fiber to centroid of your pre-stressing steel, APS represents the area of the pre-stressing steel. Now, if I draw the stress distribution diagram, I have the upper side, that is the compressive side, we have the compression, that is 0.446 FCK acting at the centroidal distance of 0.42 XU from the top fiber, XU being the depth of the neutral axis. By integrating this, the area of this parabola, that is the parabolic stress distribution, I will get it as 0.36 FCK BXU. Now, this one, that is, when it comes to the tension side, that is the stress in pre-stressing steel at the time of failure in the area will give you the tensile stress, and the leverage between these two, that I will get it as D minus, this distance I will get it as D minus 0.42 XU, that is the leverage between the tensile force and the compressive force. Now, you can see here, the formula for computing the flexural strength at a section for rectangular sections or T sections in which the neutral axis lies within the flange. That is, for this T sections, we are considering the case of the neutral axis lies within the flange. This we have discussed in the last semester. And the neutral axis lies within the flange, this T section can be considered as a rectangular section, and the equation for moment of resistance for rectangular section can be applied. So here, when you see the moment of resistance of the section, MU is equal to FPB, that is ultimate moment of resistance of the section, MU is equal to FPB, that is the tensile stress in tendons at the time of failure into area of pre-stressing steel. That is, you can see here, the tensile stress in the tendon at the time of failure into area of pre-stressing steel into leverage. Leverage is D minus 0.42 XU, that is depth. XU is the depth of the neutral axis and D is the effective depth. Now this FPB value depends upon the ratio of APS into FPU divided by BD FCK. This ratio is called as the effective reinforcement ratio, and FPU denotes the characteristic strength, tensile strength of the tendon. That is, what is the actual strength of the tendon, or at what strength it yields. That is the actual strength, characteristic tensile strength of the tendon. And FPB is the tensile stress in the tendon at the time of failure. Might be it will be sometimes less than or equal to, but we need to find out how much tensile strength this had taken at the time of failure. So if you go to your IS 1343, you can see here the moment of resistance of a rectangular section or T section in which the neutral axis lies within the flange may be denoted as MU is equal to FPB APS into D minus 0.42 XU, where MU represents the moment of resistance of the section, FPB represents the tensile stress in the tendon at failure, FPE is the effective pre-stress in tendon we will discuss, APS is the area of pretension tendons in the tension zone, D is the effective depth of the centroid of the steel, XU is the neutral axis depth. So for pretension members and for post-tension members with effective bond between the concrete and tendons, Value of FPB and XU is given in table number 11. You can see here, the table number 11 says the different values for FPB by 0.87 FPU and XU by D for a particular value of APS FPU divided by BD FCK. This I have told as the, this value is the effective reinforcement ratio. For different values of this effective reinforcement ratio, I have the value for FPB and XU. So if I know this value from table number 11, I will get the value for this FPB and XU, which means I could directly compute my moment of resistance value. So you can see here, the complete procedure to determine the moment of resistance is as, first you need to compute the APS FPU divided by BD FCK, that is the effective reinforcement ratio. Now you can refer the table number 11 and get the value for your FPB divided by 0.87 FPU. That is, once you find this value, you'll get a value here. For pre-tensioning members and post-tensioning with effective bond, you can find this value for FPB divided by 0.87 FPU. And similarly, you can find the value for XU by D. From there, you'll get the value for FPB and XU. You substitute over here, you'll get the value for your moment of resistance. Now you can see here, we need to ensure that the effective pre-stress, that is FPE, after all the losses is not less than 0.45 FPU. That is, FPE is the effective pre-stress. After all the losses, when you are calculating the final pre-stress, it should not be less than 0.45 FPU. This we have told at the time of initial losses in pre-stress. Why we are providing high tensile stress for a pre-stressing force. Now the pre-stressing tendency in the compression zone should be ignored in the strength calculation while using this method, because we will not go for a doubly reinforced section when we are using this method. This is the case for when the neutral axis lies within the flange. Now in the next class we will discuss the case for when the neutral axis lies outside the flange. Before that we will discuss some numericals. Hope you understood. Thank you. So you can see the question here. The pre-tension pre-stress concrete beam having rectangular section with a width of 150 mm and an overall depth of 350 mm is pre-stressed by tendons of an effective area of 461 mm square at an effective depth of 300 mm. Assuming the characteristic strength of concrete and steel as 40 and 1600 newton per mm square respectively, estimate the ultimate flexural strength of the section using the provisions of the Indian Standard Code. So here you are given the value for FCK as 40 and FOA as 1600. That is, you have the value for FCK as 40 and FOA as 1600. The area of pre-stressing steel, that is APS, is given as 461 mm square. The characteristic tensile stress, we have denoted it by FPU, is given as 1600 newton per mm square. That is, your 1600 newton per mm square. The width and depth of the section is respectively 150 and effective depth is 300. Now you are asked to find the ultimate strength of the section in flexure. So first, in order to find that, you have the equation for mu is equal to FPB APS into D minus 0.42 XU. That is, you have mu is equal to from annex D. You need to calculate the value for FPB and XU. The other values APS, that is area of pre-stressing steel, and effective depth is given. So in order to calculate this FPB and XU, you need to go to table number 11. You can see here table number 11. In order to calculate the value for FPB and XU, we need to have the effective reinforcement ratio, that is APS FPU divided by BD FCK. Now APS is given as, you have the value for APS as 461 mm square. Now FPU is given as 1600. B value is known to you, D value is known to you, FCK value is known to you. So once you calculate this value, you have the stress in tendons as proportion of the design strength FPB divided by 0.87 FPU for pre-tensioning and post-tensioning. In the question, it is given as a pretension member, so you need to take the value corresponding to this. Similarly, xu by d value corresponding to this. So when we calculate this value, we get APS FPU divided by BD FCK. So when we calculate this value, that is APS 461, FPU 1600, B is 150, D is 300, and FCK 40, you'll get this value as 0.4. So now, corresponding to this 0.4 value from table number 11, corresponding to this 0.4 value, if I am calculating corresponding to APS FPU divided by BD FCK for 0.4, I have FPB by 0.87, FPU as 0.9, and XU by DS 0.783. Suppose you have got 0.35, then you need to interpolate the value between these two, and similarly you need to interpolate the value between these two. So here I will get the value for these two as FPB divided by 0.87, FPU is equal to 0.9, and XU by D I got it as 0.783, which means now I can write the value for FPB as, from here FPB I can write it as 0.9 into 0.87 into FPU, that is 1600. That is, I will get this value as 1253 Newton per mm square. Similarly, I will get the XU value from here. I will get XU is equal to 0.783 times D. D here is 300 mm. So when you calculate this, this value will get it as 234.9 mm. Now substituting these two values over here, I'll get the equation for mu as mu is equal to 1253 into 461, that is FPB APS into 300, that is D minus 0.42 times XU, that is 234.9. You'll get this value as 116 kilonewton meter. So you can see the how much high the momentary resistance of a free stress member is. Now we will discuss one another question. A pretension T beam, has a flange of 300 mm and thickness of 200 mm. This is 300 mm and thickness of 200 mm. The rib is 150 mm wide and 350 mm deep. It is given this is 350 mm deep. The beam is pre-stressed by tendons of cross-sectional area 200 mm square at an effective depth of 500 mm. So we have APS as 200 mm square and effective depth D as 500 mm. FCK value is given as 50 Newton per mm square, and this is FPU. Okay, FPU value is given as 1600 Newton per mm square, that is the characteristic strength of the material. Estimate the flexural strength of the section using Indian standard specification. So here it is just simply given a T beam. The area of section is given and all the parameters are given. You are asked to determine the flexural strength. So in this code you can see this equation is common for the momentary resistance of a rectangular section as well as a T section in which the neutral axis lies within the flange. So we need to see whether the neutral axis is within the flange. Generally we can apply this equation. If the neutral axis is outside the flange, we may need to apply some another equation. So we will first assume that the neutral axis is within the flange. Assume neutral axis within the flange. So now we will find the effective reinforcement ratio, that is APS FPU divided by BD FCK. You have APS as 200, FPU as 1600 divided by 300 into 500 into 50. You will get this value as 0.04. So for 0.04 means it is between 0.025 and 0.05. So FPB by 0.87 FPU value is 0.1 here, 0.1 here. So there is no need of linear interpolation, it is same. And here it is 0.054 and 0.109. So you need to interpolate these two values. You need to find the values in between these two. So we will find it. We'll get this once we interpolate this. We'll get the value as 0.09. You need to show this in your calculation. You'll get the values as 0.09. So I can write for this FPB divided by 0.87 FPU is equal to 1, and XU by D I'll get it as 0.09. This is after interpolation, okay, which means the FPB value I got it as, FPB value is 0.87 into 1 into FPU, that is 1600. We'll get this value as 1392 Newton per mm square. And similarly XU value I'll get it as 0.09 into 500, that is just 45 mm. So here we got the XU value as 45 mm, which means XU is less than DF, which means it is within the flange, which means I can use the equation MU is equal to what? MU is equal to FPB APS into D minus 0.42 XU. This equation can be used since XU is less than DF. Otherwise, if this is not possible, we'll go for another equation that we'll discuss in the next class. So here I can write FPB is 1392 into APS is 200 into AD is 500 minus 0.42 times XU is 45. So this I'll get it as 134 kilonewton meter. So thank you, students. Next class we will see what happens when the depth of the neutral axis is outside the flange.